Jesus, and we worship for the world. Give us that confidence. Give us, as you remind us, oh God, that you have been faithful in the past. Let us just rely on that and we continue to march forward, oh God, in confidence, Lord, for you will rescue us again. You will come back and we will enthrone you this morning. God, we want to praise you and worship you this morning, for you are a king and you are the only true king and you are God alone. We just want to worship you just as you are, God. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for the people and all of us who are gathered here to praise your name this morning. So you allow us to make a beautiful noise. you on this great morning, Lord God. Thank you for this rejuvenating, rejoiceous, joy-filled praise that we have for you, Lord God. For you have also, you have been so good to every single one of us, Lord God, that we have so many reasons to praise you, and these testimonies just ring out and resonate with us when we just sing these words, Lord God. Father, we just want to enthrone you and just proclaim that you are King over our lives, and as we continue to give up more and more of our lives to you and make you Lord over all the aspects of our lives, Lord God. Father, I thank you for the testimonies that these people that we baptized are bringing to us and just showering us with their testimonies and how they've encountered you. I thank you for being so good to us, Lord God, that we get to share in the joy of others and their salvation, Lord. I thank you for the message that you'll be giving to us, Lord God. And just please allow the thanksgiving for our lives to ever cease to flow from our lives, Lord God. Thank you for this honor in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Glad that you're here this morning in our joint service. We have room in the front, so you can sit at the front if you want to. It would be great. So I'm going to make some announcements, and after making the announcement, I'm going to preach a message on Revelation. And after that, I'm going to give you a little bit of what's going to happen today, so you know clearly what's to be expected. Right, so we're going to take offering after that, and our kids going to come up, and not doing offering, or maybe in the offering, but whatever, you know, and they're going to do something, and because we all want to kind of watch our kids, how much they have grown, and how we can pray for them, and also one of our house churches for Korean adults, they're going to do a number, and after that, we'll have baptism, and during the baptism, we'll have their video testimony, so we're going to play their video testimony, and while the video is being played, we'll go and we'll change our clothes, and we'll see us behind the baptistry. Hopefully the water is there. Right, so today, we have a trend treasure. Yesterday, we filled up our SUV, so we have some good stuff there, I hope, that you guys can use. So we'll follow John's instruction in the ways that how we all open up our trunks and be ready to go and fill in your trunks with other people's treasures in their trunks, all right? And starting next Sunday, we have Advent Sundays. The four Sundays from next Sunday, we'll have an Advent Sunday celebrating that Jesus is coming 2,000 years ago, but also anticipating how Jesus will come back in the future. So four Sundays will take time to do that. We'll have two Mexico mission trips to Tijuana this winter, and one of them is through 14 through 18. We'll leave on Sunday afternoon, and we'll come back on Thursday. And another one is from 19th, which is Friday afternoon. We'll leave and come back before Christmas Eve. So if you have any questions, you can talk to Gabriel. Okay, can you stand? Gabriel, where are you? Right there. He's in charge of that. And you can ask him for more information. And you can sign up with him as soon as possible. So we have some training that we will learn some Spanish. And also today, in light of raising money for mission to Tijuana, our youth kids, they bake some cakes and cookies, and so you can buy stuff from them during our lunch time. So after our lunch, we won't have small groups today. We'll all go to the lunch room and have a big Thanksgiving feast. Can you believe this is already Thanksgiving? Mm-hmm. Time really goes fast, and this is almost in the 2014. Alright, so, did I forget anything? No? Right? It's all good, right? So today, I'm going to finish up speaking from Revelations. And you should say, wow. Today I'm going to finish up speaking from Revelations, which means that I'm going to speak from chapters 19 through 22. Because starting next Sunday, we'll have four Advent Sundays celebrating Jesus' coming 2,000 years ago and anticipating his second coming So starting next Sunday, we're going to do that. So I want to finish it up this Sunday. And starting next year, I'll do a series from life of Jesus, from the Gospels, and move on to one of the Old Testament books. So today I have to speak Korean and English together, so it'll be a little bit shorter, okay? Praise the Lord, right? 오늘은 제가 요한계시록에 대한 설교를 끝내겠습니다. Wow. Wow. 22장까지 말씀을 전하고 다음 주부터 4주 동안 대림절 예수님이 2000년 전에 이미 오셨던 것과 다시 오실 것을 기대하는 것을 4주 동안 설교하고 내년부터는 복음서에서 예수님에 대한 시리즈를 설교하고 다시 구약으로 넘어가겠습니다. I'm going to just give you a survey of four chapters by giving you the chapter summary and focus on last part of chapter 22 as Jesus gives us the application.
여러분에게 짧게 줄거리를 말씀해 드리고 22장에 나오는 예수님의 계시 속에 있는 적용을 여러분에게 집중해 드리겠습니다.
First, remember that this is a slideshow containing some clips, not a full scripted movie. Right? This does not contain all the details of what will happen. So this is not a full scripted of the future. Like I said before, these are series of visions that helps us to know the future, giving us the confidence and appropriate warning, not a complete script of what's going to happen in the future. The point of this vision is that we can trust God, and we can continue to follow God, and we can trust of what God has said and what He said in the Bible, and we remain faithful in relationship with God and Jesus in the future of anticipating of Jesus' return.
먼저 우리가 기억해야 될 것은 계시록은 마지막 때에 완전하게 자세하게 보여주는 영화가 아니라 몇 장면만 보여주는 계시입니다. 이 장면들이 우리에게 미래를 알려주고 이 미래에 대한 자신감과 경고를 받으면서 하나님을 더욱더 믿고 예수 그리스도를 따르며 예수님이 오실 때까지 충성하라는 것을 우리에게 말씀해 주시는 겁니다.
So, you know, I talked several weeks ago, the Revelation chapter 17, 18 covered the destruction of Babylon. Destruction of the Babylon. The world as anti-God. It was destroyed suddenly, completely, and quickly. Remember that. Suddenly, completely, and quickly. What are they?
Suddenly, completely,
quickly. The world got destroyed. It shows us that the world is in sinking sand, and we cannot trust the world.
요한계시록 17장하고 18장은 바벨론이 멸망하는 것을 보았습니다. 바벨론은 하나님을 적대하는 세상을 상징하는 것이고 이 세상이 갑자기 완전히 속하게 빨리 멸망했다는 것을 보여줬습니다. 세상은 믿을 게 못 되고 반석이 아니라는 것을 보여주시는 겁니다.
Revelation 19:20 is about praising God for God's salvation, glory, and power. God is the righteous judge and rightly destroyed the world and readies the church for a wedding to her bridegroom, which is Jesus Christ. And the Christ, the warrior Messiah, appears riding on the white horse in a full description of his awesome nature and demonstrating his power by swift victory over beast, the false prophet, and the Satan. The universe, when you read on, is amazing. The universe is dissolved and the people of the world are resurrected, right, to be judged and sent to the lake of fire with Satan and the false prophet and the beast. You get to see that. It's, you know, Peter, what did you say?
Sound victory.
Sound victory. So it's not like going overtime, but it's a sound victory Jesus has over the Satan, the beast, and the false prophet, and to the world.
So 요한계시록 19장과 20장은 하나님의 구원과 영광과 능력을 보여주시는 것이고 그분이 참되고 의로운 심판을 찬양하는 장면입니다. 예수님의 신부이신 교회, 믿는 사람들, 우리를 손사에 준비시키고 신랑이신 예수 그리스도가 흰말을 타고 등장합니다. 예수님의 능력이 사탄을 신속하게 단순히 굴복시키고 사탄과 짐승과 거짓 예언자를 잡아 불바다에 집어넣습니다. 이 우주는 용해 되고 모든 불신자들이 부활하여 다시 심판받는 것을 심판받아 불바다에 들어가게 됩니다. So chapter 21 begins with the new heaven. New heaven comes down and new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth has passed away. The holy city, this amazing city, the new Jerusalem, which represents the people of God from the Old Testament and the New Testament, comes down from heaven. 1500 miles this way, 1500 miles this way, and 1500 miles tall, this citizen of city are God's people who are fully satisfied and have overcome the world. The verse 7, 21:7 says, He who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexual immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. So, 21장은 하늘과 이전에 하늘과 땅이 사라졌으므로 새 하늘과 새 땅이 생기는 장면입니다. 거룩한 도시 이 어마어마한 새 예루살렘은 하나님의 구약의 백성들과 신약의 백성들이 2,200km 이쪽으로 저쪽으로는 2,200km 높이로도 2,200km의 굉장한 도시가 하늘에서 내려옵니다. 이 도시는 하나님의 백성을 상징하는 것이고 이 완전한 만족감 안에서 세상을 이긴 자들이 있는 도시들입니다. 그래서 21장 7절에는 이기는 자는 이것들을 유업으로 얻으리라. 나는 저의 하나님이 되고 그는 내 아들이 되리라. 그러나 두려워하는 자들과 믿지 않는 자들과 흉악과 자들과 살인자들과 행음자들과 술객들과 우상 숭배자들과 모든 거짓말하는 자들은 불과 유황으로 타는 못에 그죠? 연못이 가득한 참여하리니 이것이 둘째 사망이라. So the chapter 22 verse 6 through 21, right? This section, this last section of the book of Revelation, God gives us the final challenge. That is something that I'm going to focus. A final challenge and application. Heaven is our destination and also is our motivation. You know, knowing that there is a heaven, our final destination, and all the things that we read about in this book of Revelation and all the books in the Bible, it ought to make a difference in our lives today, right here and right now. The saints of the Old Testament and the saints of the New Testament times have lived in this view of heaven. You know, more you grow and more you are like Jesus, the more you will enjoy heaven. You guys get that? More you are like Jesus, more that you are enjoying Christ at this moment, the more that you will enjoy heaven. Heaven should make us complacent. Heaven should make us careless. Heaven just put us in the cruising mode, but it should spur us. It will encourage us to live like the salt and the light of this world, fulfilling all our calling, because the heaven is coming soon. There are three specific applications that Jesus talks about that we ought to grow in. They are this. You should write this down. Obedient life to God's word. obedient life to God's word. Gospel-centered life in cleansing and conquering sin. Gospel-centered life in cleansing and conquering sin. Expecting Jesus to return lifestyle. Expecting Jesus to return lifestyle. Right? So, 우리가 여기서 세 가지의 마지막으로 도전과 적용을 보여주시는데 이 세 가지의 도전과 적용은 말씀에 순종된 삶. 말씀에 순종된 삶. 그리고 죄의 사함을 받고 죄를 이기는 복음주의의 삶. 죄의 사함 받고 죄를 이기는 복음주의의 삶. 그리고 almost spoken English there. 예수님을 기대하고 기다리는 삶입니다. 예수님을 기대하고 기다리는 삶. Sometimes I get confused. I say, did I speak in English or did I speak in Korean? Yeah. So it's very important. So I'm going to focus on those three things. 세 가지만 집중하겠습니다. Obedient life to the word of God. Obedient life. That's the application God gives us. You know, Bible is the word of God. Amen? Bible is not from men. Yes, God used men to write. Spirit gave up, right? Spirit breathing them to write the word of God. But this is a revelation from Him. This is out of this world. Right? This instruction, His wisdom, His teaching, His training manual, right, is for us. Knowing God's character to give us an abundant life has given us His word to follow. And it's like a very complicated, very expensive machine. It's instruction manual for that. More complicated, more expensive it is, more instruction there is. And without instruction, you cannot fully utilize it and you cannot fully enjoy this expensive and priceless machine. Just like us. You know how we need His Word of God. How we need to follow the Word of God to enjoy, to live this life as an abundant life. We really need this. It's not like God needs us, but we need Him. Amen? Amen? We need Him all the days of our lives. That's why the Bible says, Behold, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to everyone according to what he has done. In the ways that we have received His word, in the ways that we have responded to the word of God, God will give us the reward based on how we have received His word and how we have obeyed His word and how we have lived with His word. So remember this, obedience to God's word is a mark of a true salvation. Wow, you should say that. Wow, we'll try one more time. Obedience to God's word is the true mark of a true salvation.
Wow.
When you say wow, I try to understand this. You understand? Obedience, right? Obedience to God's word is a mark of a true salvation. If you are saved, you will obey.
Amen.
It's just the way it is. So you examine your life. Am I living a life of obedience or living a life of disobedience? It's not just talking about, me and God were fine, but I just do whatever else in the context of body of Christ. That's not like that either. Because God speaks to me through people. Right? Rebuking, training, and learning and teaching, it happens through, in our context of our relationship. So how you take seriously in the ways that you listen to the Word of God, and how that Word of God is spoken through people, that is the true mark of my salvation in Christ. 성경 말씀은 하나님의 말씀입니다. 하나님께서 우리에게 계시하시는 말씀이기 때문에 사람에게서 온 것이 아닙니다. 이것은 사람을 통해서 성령님께서 불어주신 것이기 때문에 하나님의 지혜와 하나님의 지시와 가르침과 삶의 방식을 주신 것입니다. 값비싼 기계의 사용서가 필요한 것처럼 하나님의 자비하심이 우리에게 풍성한 삶을 주시기 위하여 사용서를 우리에게 주신 것입니다. 사용서대로 사용했을 때 최고로 사용할 수 있는 것처럼 우리의 삶도 말씀을 순종할 때 최고로 살 수 있다는 것입니다. 이 말씀대로 살았을 때 우리 주님께서 우리에게 상을 주신다고 22장 11절에 보라 내가 속히 오리니 내가 줄 상이 내게 있어 각 사람에게 그의 일한 대로 갚아주리라. 하나님께서 우리를 위해서 사용서를 주신 것입니다. 말씀의 순종은 진정한 구원의 표시입니다. 말씀의 순종은 진정한 구원의 표시입니다. 우리가 구원을 받았나 구원을 안 받았나의 표시는 우리가 말씀을 얼마나 순종하가 얼마나 순종하지 않은가입니다. 부모님과의 관계처럼 부모님하고 좋은 관계가 있으면 부모님의 말씀을 잘 순종합니다. 부모님과 관계에 그게 잘 못 성장했을 때 부모님의 관계가 안 좋았을 때 우리는 부모님의 말씀을 잘 안 듣습니다. 똑같이 하나님의 말씀, 하나님에서 구원을 받았을 때 하나님과 관계가 좋았을 때 우리는 말씀에 순종이 있다는 것입니다. That's the first thing. Obedience to God's word is a mark of true salvation. 말씀의 순종은 진정한 구원의 표시입니다. I almost forgot which. Okay, second of all, gospel-centered life in cleansing and conquering sin. Gospel-centered life in cleansing and conquering sin. Verse 14 says this, blessed are those who wash their robes and they may have the rights to the tree of life and may go through the gates into the city. You know, how do you get our robes cleansed? How? It is washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's the only way that our robes get cleansed. It's a very continuous thing. It's talking about gospel-centered life. And gospel-centered life is a life that is so focused on Jesus Christ. There's no way we can get our robes washed without the blood of Jesus Christ. There's no way we can experience life transformation without having Christ's Spirit living in us. Yes, we do stumble here and there, but God continuously washes us and we resist sin so hard because Jesus died for our sins and we experience transformation. You know, our confidence is not in ourselves. Our confidence is not even in our faith. Our confidence is in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Our confidence is in the strength. Our confidence is in the ways that He has begun a good work in us. And He will finish it until the day of Jesus Christ. You know, in some cases, yes, we do need to hear out each other. But many times, we're so focused on us. We're so focused in where we've been, what we have done, how we have messed up, and how we got messed up from other people. And yes, we do need to hear that, but most importantly, we need to focus where Jesus has been. What did He do? What did He do for me? And unless we're not focusing that, we'll be so bombarded with this, our thing, and our focus on our thing, and even the tree of our sufferings or whatever, and we'll miss out the life of Jesus Christ. He came. He gave up heaven. He came, He died for our sins so that we may be free and live in Him.
Amen.
We cannot forget about that. From the beginning, God speaks to us how big, how strong, and how mighty He is, that in knowing this truth, we will be set free from focusing on us. It's like looking at a masterpiece of a picture. Then as you look at that, your little picture that you have in the corner, it looks strangely dim in front of a masterpiece. That's how it looks. Because He is mighty. Because He is powerful. And He is big. Even in our prayer, our focus is on Jesus. How big He is. How strong He is. And how mighty He is. In that reality, we get to know more of Him, and in that knowing, our hearts and our minds will be transformed and to be like Him. Now, look how differently also that we Christians are to live than the non-Christians. Verse 22 of 15 says, outside are the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the sexual immoral, the murderers,
the idolaters, and everyone who loves the and practice falsehood. So this gospel-centered life focuses on Jesus. And I know sometimes we want to focus on our lives, and you got to take your eyes upon yourself and focus on Jesus. Right? And sometimes you become the distracting factor in looking at Jesus. And how you need to focus on, more focused we are in Jesus, more transformation you will experience. More focused you are on Jesus. Even right now, what are you focused on? What are you going to have for lunch? Oh, the Thanksgiving lunch. Are we going to have turkey? I'm not sure. Maybe chicken. Or maybe some Korean food. What are you focused on? When you wake up in the morning, what are you focused on? What's the first thing you do? I don't know, 50% of people, when you wake up, check your phone. They say about 12% of people these days, they check the phone throughout the night. What are we focused on? Somebody gonna message you? Somebody Kakao talking you or whatever? Like, wow. What about God? Are we focused on, more focused we are in Jesus, more transformation we will experience. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. He makes us different because He lives in us. He cleanses us and He makes us more than conquerors to live victoriously in this world. It's all about Him. Yesterday at the baptism training, I told them, we are like the glove. You know? When you leave a glove there, what happens? He just lays there. He's dead. Glove's dead, right? And so we are like that. And as we get baptized, what happens is a symbol for that we are dead. We are identified with Christ, that we are, that it is no longer who I live, but it is Christ who lives in me. So what happened? There's glove, and the Spirit of God comes in us, then what? And the Spirit of God lives through us. And so when we are focused in the Spirit of Jesus, in Jesus, life of Jesus, He will come inside of us, and He will live this life for God's glory. 우리가 어떻게 두루마기를 깨끗하게 합니까? 우리는 절대로 할 수 없는 것입니다. 예수님께서 흘린 보혈로서만 가능한 일입니다. 예수님의 흘린 보혈로서만 우리의 두루마기가 깨끗하게 되는 것입니다. 이것이 바로 복음주의의 삶을 말합니다. 복음주의의 삶은 예수님께 집중하는 삶입니다. 예수님의 보혈 없이는 깨끗이도 못하고 우리가 살 수도 없는 것입니다. 예수님의 영이 우리 안에 없으면 변화할 수도 없습니다. 우리의 실수 속에서도 하나님께서 계속 우리를 깨끗하게 해주시고 예수님께서 죄 때문에 죽으셨기 때문에 죄를 적대하고 삶이 변화되는 것입니다. 우리가 신뢰하는 것은 우리가 아닙니다. 우리가 믿는 것은 우리가 아닙니다. 우리가 믿는 것이 우리의 믿음도 아닙니다. 우리가 자랑하는 것도 우리의 믿음이 아니라 예수님을 자랑하는 거고 예수님을 믿는 것입니다. 우리는 우리에게 집중되었던 우리가 우리는 항상 우리에게만 집중됐기 때문에 우리가 어디에서 어떻게 무엇을 했나가 중요하지만 더 중요한 것은 예수님께서 어디에서 어떻게 무엇을 했냐가 더 중요한 것입니다. 네. 우리는 우리가 예수님을 보는데 반대가 되는 것이에요. 왜? 우리는 항상 우리에게 집중해야 되기 때문에. 여러분 우리 군사진 보면 누구를 먼저 보십니까? 우리 먼저 봐요. 예수님이 어디 계신가 보는 게 아니라. 안 그래요 여러분? 우리의 모임이 예수님이 보이는 것인데 우리는 우리를 보는 게 아니라 우리에게 집중되어 있기 때문에 예수님을 많은 경우에 미스하고 있습니다. 처음부터 예수님께서 얼마나 전능하시고 얼마나 훌륭하시고 얼마나 크신지를 알 때 우리가 우리를 집중해서부터 자유를 얻고 하나님께 집중할 수 있습니다. 우리의 기도도 예수님께 집중하는 것처럼 시작부터 끝날 때까지 이러한 진리에서 우리가 더욱 예수님처럼 닮아가서 더 예수님처럼 살 수 있다는 것입니다. 네. 우리가 침례 받는 이유도 우리는 정말 장갑처럼 장갑이 있으면 죽지 않아요. 아무것도 안 움직이잖아요. 우리가 예수님과 함께 십자가에 돌아간 것처럼 우리 안에 죽은 우리가 예수님의 성령님이 들어와서
우리를 통해서 예수님이 살 수 있다는 것입니다. 이 중요한 것은 장갑의 중점이 아니라 그 장갑 안에서 역사하시는 예수님의 중심이라는 것입니다. 이게 바로 복음주의의 삶입니다. 우리가 예수님을 바라보는데 우리가 방해가 돼요. 우리가 방해가 됩니다. 방해를 없애버리고, 방해는 죽었으니까, 우리 죽었잖아요, 이제. 그렇기 때문에 우리 안에 역사하시는 예수님만을 초점으로 볼 수 있다는 것입니다. 15절에는 우리가 세상 사람들과 얼마나 다른 삶을 사는지 보여줍니다. 그죠? 거기는 걔네들이 아니라 멍멍. 왜 항상 그 개하고 진짜 백성하고 분리가 되는 거기 때문에 개들과 술객들과 행운자들과 살인자들과 우상 숭배들과 및 거짓말을 좋아하는 좋아하며 지어내는 자마다 성 밖에 있으리라. 네. 얼마나 우리의 삶, 그리스도의 삶, 그리스도를 믿는 사람들, 그리스도가 안에 있는 사람들의 삶과 그리스도가 없는 사람들이 다른 삶을 사는 건지 보여주는 겁니다. 여기서 말씀해 주시는 것은 예수님께 더 집중된 삶은 예수님을 더 많이 닮는다는 사실입니다. 여러분, 예수님과 닮기 원하시죠?
네.
그러면 뭡니까? 예수님과 더욱더, 예수님께 더욱더 집중해야 된다는 것입니다. 여러분이 방해가 되지만 방해를 없애버리고, 방해는 죽었도다. 이제 새 것이 되었기 때문에 우리가 더욱더 예수님만을 집중하고 그분을 닮을 수 있다는 것입니다. More focus you are in Christ, more transformation that you will be able to experience. Don't you want to be transformed like Jesus? Isn't that your hope? Yeah, that's our hope. We want to be like Jesus. And Jesus lives in us. And He helps us to live like Him. And the more focused you are in Jesus, and that's the life of the gospel, focused life. Thirdly, expecting Jesus to return lifestyle. Expecting Jesus to return lifestyle. 예수님을 기대하고 기다리는 삶입니다. Three times, verse 7, verse 12, verse 20, it talks about, Behold, I am coming soon. If you have one of those Bibles that Jesus' words in red, it talks about that. Behold, I'm coming soon. Behold, I'm coming soon. Verse 12, my reward is with me. Right? And verse 20 says, He who testifies to these things says, Yes, I am coming soon. He's telling us again and again that He is coming soon. Three times Jesus said that He will come soon, but He has delayed for nearly 2,000 years. Yes, He has delayed, but Peter tells us why. Why? God wants to give this sinful world opportunity to repent and be saved. He's active in seeking and saving the lost. As we expect His return to judge and reward, we partner with Jesus in carrying out His mission. That ought to provoke us to do ministry and evangelism and missions as well as purity in our hearts. Knowing that Jesus will come back, it ought to motivate us in doing the things that Jesus wants us to do in missions, in evangelism, and purity in heart. Yeah. Look at how we ought to respond in verse 20. When Jesus says that He's coming soon, how do they respond? Amen! Everybody say amen!
Amen!
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus! Come, Lord Jesus, I'm coming soon! And people will hear that and they say, Amen! Come, Lord Jesus! That's how they will respond. That is the biblical response. It's not just saying this, but saying it with expectancy of His return. And in obedience to His word, living a gospel-centered life, and carrying on the call that He has for our lives. 세 번씩이나 예수님께서 속히 오신다고 나옵니다. 하지만 거의 2000년이 늦춰지지만 그 이유는 하나님께서 죄인들에게 기회를 주시는 이유입니다. 죄인들을 회개시키고 구원시키는 역사를 위한 늦춰짐입니다. 예수님께서 죄인을 찾고 구원시키는 일에 우리가 기다리면서 그냥 기다리는 게 아니라 예수님과 함께 예수님이 원하시는 일에 같이 동참하는 우리를 말하는 겁니다. 무슨 일입니까? 예수님께서 늦춰지는 이유가 그 죄인들을 찾고 구원시키기 때문에 우리도 그 일에 동참해서 잃어버린 사람들을 찾고 구원시키는 일이 우리가 남아서 해야 될 일입니다. 우리가 예수님께서 곧 오신다는 대답에 어떻게 대답이 나옵니까? 20절에는 이렇게 나옵니다. 아멘! 주 예수여 오시옵소서. 그냥 말로 오시옵소서. 식당에 어서오시오. 그게 아니라 아멘 주여 오시옵소서라는 것은 내가 주님의 말씀에 순종하면서 기다린다는 것과 죄의 사함을 받고 죄를 이기는 복음주의를 산다는 것과 예수님을 기대하고 기다리면서 예수님과 함께 동참하는 삶을 산다는 것을 대답하는 것입니다.
네.
여러분, 예수님이 오실 때, 근데 곧 오시게 됐는데, 그죠? 예수님이 오실 때에 예수님께서 기뻐하시고, 정말 우리가 정말, 빨리빨리 만나봐야 되겠다, 라는 그런 감정과 그런 진리 안에서 예수님의 말씀을 순종하고, 그죠? 예수님을 더욱더 초점을 맞추며, 복음주의의 삶을 살며, 예수님이 하시는 일에 동참하는 여러분이 될 수 있도록 주님의 이름으로 축원하겠습니다. You know, our hope is this, that as we expect Jesus to return, it's not just expecting to return, but live this life in obedience to God. Live this life in focusing on Jesus Christ and live a gospel-centered life. And including Jesus, right, is doing what Jesus wants us to do, focusing on His mission and His work and His calling in our lives. And that's what Jesus wants. And that's how this whole book Bible, right, Revelation ends, giving us that challenge, giving us that application. How will you wait? It's not just twirling your thumb, but it's active waiting in obedience, in living that gospel-centered life, in life of mission and evangelism for the glory of God. Amen?
Amen.
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 Oh, that was a breathful. Thank you for paying attention. And let me pray for us. Father God, we thank you so much for your word. Father, it's not that your word needs us, but we need your word. We need your revelation. We need this instruction to live this life in abundance. But Father, thank you so much for revealing it to us, giving to us, and using men and women to give us this holy scripture to us so that we can experience you. Father, as we expectantly wait for you, we don't want to just wait a passive wait, but we want to wait actively, obeying your words, meditating your words day and night, and focusing on you and living a life that is gospel-centered life, cleansing of our robes each day, understanding who Jesus is and what He has done for us, and being on mission with you, seeking and saving what was lost. Father, help us to focus on that, and we wait expectantly that you will return anytime. We thank you for your revelation. We ask for your grace to work in our lives so that we can live a life that is pleasing to you. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Alright, so we like to invite the little kids. Let's take offering first. Let's take offering first. So kids don't have to come on yet. Yeah, we want to just focus on offering based on what we said, based on the word that has been gone out. Really examining your heart. Hey, do I live a life of obedience?
Do I live a life of obedience? Do I know the Word of God? Do I meditate upon the Word of God day and night? Do we live a life of obedience? That's so important. Obedient life is a mark of a true salvation. And are we living a life that centers around the gospel? Do we get our robes cleansed each day? Not just focusing on ourselves, even just our difficulty, or even our victories, but who Jesus is, how He lived, and what He has done, and how He has bled for our sins, and how He is victorious. But we wait expectantly, being on mission with Him, to seeking and saving what was lost. And as we offer our lives unto that calling, that life, that challenging life, that application that we ought to apply in our lives, we want to take this time of offering our lives to that calling. Amen?
Amen. I'm going to send it to Kenneth, that's fine, you know.
Oh, hi, Kenneth.
Hi, Kenneth.
Oh, hi, Kenneth. Nice to know you.
Doing well.
Oh, make sure we get this corner, too. Kids, you guys ready? You're not just watching the performance, you're just actually praying for them, you know that, right?
Yeah.
How they can live the lifestyle that we're just talking about.
cute, this one's like that too. But I'm just kidding, you're still cute because Jesus lives in you, amen?
Amen.
Come, brother! Okay, we have a Korean adults, one of the, we have two house churches in Korean side, and one of them is going to do a very cool number. It's called the Pilgrim Song. It's written by a Korean guy. So I was looking for the lyrics for, what's it? I was looking for the lyrics for longest time, but then I suddenly realized it's not an English song, it's a Korean song. So I translated a little bit on my own, so just kind of read along what they're saying.
Thank you.
right? We're just temporarily going through this spot, this place. So we're focusing on heaven and the mission that God has given us to live in this world. So we're going to have baptism. So those people who are getting baptized, please go and get changed. And while we go change, there is a tour video that you'll be playing. And so they gave testimony yesterday. We recorded it. It's on there. So quiet silence and just really listen to what they're saying. All right? And we'll be back.
When reading Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 32. In these verses, Jesus showed my importance to God by telling the parable of the lost son. In the story, a young man demanded his inheritance from his father, even when he wasn't dead yet, and after receiving his share, ran away from home. Then a great famine struck, and the young man was left poor and hungry. After going empty-bellied for a long time, he went back home to see if they had any food. When he was a long way off, his father ran out to greet him, hugging him with compassion. He became so happy that he threw a big celebration for him. Jesus showed me that I resembled the young man. By this story, I saw that the father has always been forgiving to him even before the son took his money, and that the son finally saw the father's love for him when he returned. As soon as I saw God's love for me, I realized I didn't have to rely on my ability to believe, but God's ability to forgive and to save. Afterwards, I felt happy that I understood my struggles, and I accepted Christ then and there. Now, I want to live my new life in Christ by spreading God's word through kids in my school, not by forcing them, but by showing them a new path and the benefits from it. After that, all I can do is pray for those I've reached out to and hope that they would turn toward God and accept Christ.
그 안에는 하나님에 대한 것은 없었습니다. 한국에 있을 때는 하나님을 믿지 않았었고 내 상관은 무관하다고 생각하며 살아왔습니다. 좋은 학교에 갔고 좋은 직장에 취직하는 것 모두가 제가 열심히 한 결과라고 생각했었습니다. 그러니 당연히 제 삶에 감사는 없었겠죠. 그런데 5년 전에 미국에 간호학 박사 과정을 공부하기 위해 왔고 선배가 다니는 교회에 다니게 되면서 하나님을 믿게 되었습니다. 하나님께서 나의 길을 예배하여 주시고 인도하시며 힘들 때 위로하여 주시고 이겨낼 수 있는 힘을 주시고 좋은 사람들을 붙여주시고 기도할 수 있게 하여 주셨습니다. 무엇보다도 감사할 수 있는 삶을 살게 하여 주셨고 감사와 기도가 얼마나 기쁜 것인지 알게 하여 주셨습니다. 제 안에 계시는 하나님으로 인해 제 삶에 너무나도 많은 변화가 일어났습니다. 그 중에 제일 큰 변화는 다른 사람들을 위해 기도하는 것입니다. 그리고 힘들 때 하나님을 더 붙잡고 기도하게 된 것입니다. 앞으로도 하나님께서 저의 삶을 어떻게 인도해 주실지 기대가 됩니다. 계속 기도하며 하나님 음성에 순종하는 삶을 살고 싶습니다. 감사합니다.
4 years old, I accepted Jesus in my heart. I had grown up in a Christian household, in the church, and in a private school up until I graduated from junior high. But when I entered high school, a lot of different aspects in my life changed, such as entering into public school for the first time. A lot of circumstances also occurred in my home due to past problems which I had been unaware of. Without me realizing it, these things affected me and my behavior in school, and in many ways deferred me from growing. Not only spiritually, but physically, mentally, and emotionally. Entering college, I had a difficult time my first year. First, it started with mainly problems with my grades at school. Then I began to feel completely incompetent in my course of study, engineering. In turn, that began to affect me in many ways. Socially, I felt like an outcast, especially at a school that, on the surface, seemed to be filled with brilliant students who for sure knew what they wanted to do in life, even though that wasn't true. I hadn't realized it, but because of the problems at home, I had tried to grow up completely independent of my family. It was hard for me to ask anyone for help. But as God placed different people in my life, I learned I needed help. I couldn't walk through life without God and without others to help me. Through a lot of rebuke and self-reevaluation, I began to seek out God in every part of my life. I had always felt a longing and emptiness in my heart that caused my mind to overthink situations, which I had tried to fill with things of this world. However, as I began to surround myself with more people who listened to my problems and were able to help me walk in the ways of Christ, that discomfort and emptiness in my heart slowly but surely began to be filled. Even now, He continuously blesses me with more joys in my life to get through the tough days. And although at times I stray, I know He's always there for me, and He's never going to let go of me. Thank you.
I felt lost. That lost feeling was omnipresent, forever giving me a feeling that something was missing from my life. Because of this, I determined early enough that I needed a compass, a map, or a person to lead me to the right direction. During my search, I realized that I had great darkness in me, and I had fear of what I was to become. During high school, I took one semester out of two of the required semesters in catechism that would have allowed me to become a Catholic member of the church. However, complications arose after the first semester and I never went back. However, this portrays God's effort inside of me to surface and lead me towards Him. Even in my first year of college, I signed up to Bible studies in Christian groups. But not knowing anyone from the Christian community stopped me from attending. This is when I asked God to assist me on my journey towards Him. Curiously enough, I found out that God had already answered my prayer. Through a series of coincidences that fell in place miraculously, God sent me a compass that would lead me towards Him once and for all. This compass came in the form of a person that I immediately befriended. Much like an angel, He led me away from sin and directed me towards Journey, this church. I happened to come along to Journey on Journey's Union Night. Every person at this event radiated with joy and love. Unknown to me at first, I found peace here at Journey. But then I asked God, was this my final destination? And the answer was no. God had brought me to Journey as a way to allow me to surrender my life towards Him and attempt to follow His footsteps. In essence, these are my last words for which today I die and only to rise again with the Holy Spirit guiding me.
In the ways that God has a wonderful plan
for him to be saved at such a young age and how he's going to live out his life forever and ever. And you heard how he wants to share Christ with his classmates. So let's continue to pray for him. So I'm going to ask him a question, and we'll pray together, and we baptize him together. Okay. Tona, have you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Thanks for asking. Okay. Father God, we thank you so much for Tona's life and their family. It is so evident that how you are alive and well, working in their family, and how you have saved Jonah. And Jonah was able to acknowledge and to know that his faith is not in his faith, but his faith is in you. That you are the Alpha and you are the Omega. You are the beginner and you are the perfecter and you are the finisher who have begun a good work in Jonah, and we're confident that you will finish it. Father, please work in him and give him boldness to share Christ with his friends at school. Help him to grow intellectually, help him to grow emotionally, socially, so that he can live this life where Christ lives in him so actively and so powerfully that you will receive maximum glory from his life. And upon his confession that Jesus Christ is his Lord and Savior, we baptize him in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The reason is
is that you're so social. And we pray that God will use Vera and her socialness to preach Christ, to make Jesus known to all over the world. You know, like Hamilton is Filipino, and Elizabeth is Filipino. And let's continue to pray for Vera and how she can be a spokesperson for Christ in all the things that she does. And she's in the PCE, Filipino Culture Club, you know, where Sora kind of thing founded a club, like when she went to school, you know, and so we want to really pray for her. Now I'm going to ask her a question, then we'll pray for her, and we'll baptize her together. Ira, have you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior? Yeah. Father God, we thank you so much for Ira's life. We thank you so much for you have saved her such a young age, and that throughout these years, all those sufferings and hardships, you have refined her, and we see the image of Christ out of her. Father, I know your work is not done yet, and you're continuously working in her, refining her, so that your reflection in through her life will come out brighter, stronger, and more powerful. Father God, in all the things that she is doing, we pray your special anointing in her life so that she can be your powerful spokesperson for Jesus Christ. We pray that she will be so focused on you that she will not be focused on herself or whatever that she goes through, but that she will be so focused on you and experience amazing life transformation in her life, and that you will use her powerfully, make your name known to this lost world. Upon her confession that Jesus Christ is her Lord and Savior, we baptize her in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
Wow, she is.
He's alive. Amen. He's real dead, but he's alive in Christ. We are dead. Galatians 2:20 says, we were crucified with Christ. It is no longer who I live, but it is Christ who lives in me. We're not the dead love. Invite the Spirit to continue to live in us, so that that life that we live is not of ourselves, but it is of Christ. Amen? Let's pray. Let me pray for you. And we can all mingle a little bit and make your way to the fellowship hall. Oh. Now, yeah, okay. That's right. We're going to have a song show. Then John will take over from now, okay? Let me pray for all of us. Let's all stand up. My perfect day in the time. Look at that. That was so good. Hallelujah, everybody. Father God, we thank you so much for this glorious day. I know for sure that you're in heaven smiling upon us, for we are your children. And how we have received your love and your Spirit lives in us, and we want to live this life in calling, in missions, and to live this life, this new life you've given us with purpose and meaning. Father, we thank you so much for giving us this body of Christ, where we can celebrate how you have come and how you have died for our sins and how you have been active in our lives to bring salvation and bring transformation and growth in our lives, Father. We praise you, for you are worthy, for we give you hand, and we just want to acknowledge that we want to focus our life on you, Father God. Father, as we go from this place, may your word just remain very strongly in our hearts. That we may be focused on that. We may obey what you're saying and be cleansed each day, living that gospel-centered life. That we may expectantly wait for you, not just passively, but actively in obeying and living that gospel-centered life for your glory's sake. We thank you. In Jesus Christ's name, we pray. Amen.
All right, you don't really need to listen to me, but today is Trunk Treasures, and so Trunk Treasures is the time when we share our possessions with other members of the church, those who may be interested in kind of useful things that we might not necessarily need at the moment. So why don't we go ahead and have a time of fellowship in the parking lot, and then in, say, 3 or 4 minutes, I'll tell everyone to go to your cars, and then on my signal, everyone opens up your trunk, and then you can go from trunk to trunk and take what you find useful. So be sure to treat other trunks as if they were your own. Don't take anyone's car jack or anything like that. And if you have items in your trunk, make sure they're only items that you would like taken. All right? So, have a time fellowship in the parking lot, and then I will let you know in a few minutes.
This one is not to be